Namaskaram. July 21st, 2021, episode 208. Hello and welcome to Daily Global Insights with Sri and Sri. Let's begin by taking a look at global news. Global news. Amidst COVID fears, Tokyo Olympic Games are set to open on Friday as Japan tries to bring cheer to Olympics. Indonesia extends lockdown through the weekend, Singapore to tighten curbs as COVID cases rise. Delta hit ASEAN turns to vaccine mixing and boosters. We've already told you yesterday about the failure of some of the vaccine manufacturers such as Sinovac. Sridharji, welcome to P Guru's channel and Daily Global Insights and your thoughts on what's happening around the world, sir.
Good morning, everybody, and on this bright but little hazy morning here from New York. Well, I think that the Japan, most important, the world watches the Olympics kickoff on Friday, which is in less than 48 hours. The games have started, some of the other games have started. There was the first game, the softball game between Japan and I think Australia. And as you rightly pointed out, as Delta variant takes shape around Asia, especially Southeast Asia, now they're trying to use different combination from cocktails to mixing and matching of vaccines to ensure that this Delta variant doesn't spread. There seems to be a tightening of controls in Singapore, so they're not allowing mass gatherings, they're allowing no more than two, but all within the context of trying to contain this epidemic or pandemic.
And United Kingdom will deploy permanently two patrol vessels to the Indo-Pacific following the deployment of carrier strike group led by HMS Queen Elizabeth. Where the Quad has fallen out, UK seems to have stepped in, sir. Your thoughts?
Well, I think it is very clear. I think Japan is concerned about, notwithstanding the fact United States has been closely coordinating some actions with their SDF, Strategic Defense Forces. Japan has highlighted Taiwan as China-Taiwan threat, as a threat that is imminent to Japan itself. So therefore, they have highlighted for the first time in the defense manual. So Japan is taking much more proactive steps and making sure that there is contingent plans in place to address the Taiwan issue in the event that there is an imminent or in the event of an attack and US doesn't toe the line. So what they have done, now they seems to have closely worked with UK. UK has now added patrol boats to already the strike carrier that is docked in the Indo-Pacific area in the event of any adversity. And so this poses broader question, where is Quad? And right around this time, we reported yesterday, Lloyd Austin is visiting. He's visiting Singapore, he's visiting Vietnam, he's visiting Philippines for broader discussions. Where is Quad? Where is Quad in terms of much more coordinated exercises and saying that there is a defensive formation in place and China should not be flexing any muscles and Taiwan is not negotiable. But this is not Mike Pompeo. Antony Blinken is invisible and only you see Lloyd Austin making trips around the region.
And China wants Lithuania over Taiwan opening a representative office and further not to send wrong signals to the independent forces in Taiwan. China dismisses US and EU accusation of a global hacking campaign. We talked about this yesterday. Also, I think Lithuania is the second country to give Taiwan recognition in terms of allowing them to use that name, isn't it, sir?
It is not only to use the name. Taiwan will be opening a representative office, a diplomatic representative, first formal diplomatic representative office in Lithuania. They provided the space, and that is for formal recognition of accepting Taiwan as an independent nation. This is where the Chinese are getting flustered, and they've issued a statement that, please do not do it. Well, that's what they do. And you saw United States respond very meekly. And especially Kurt Campbell made a statement, we have to accept and understand the sensitivity in the region as far as Taiwan issue is concerned. This was his statement, right? So whereas Lithuania has taken a much more bolder measure. The last point that you mentioned, whenever there is anything that is as linked with China, China immediately rebuts without any evidence, anything, which is simply to say that U.S. and EU allegations are false. We'll be covering this a little more in detail tomorrow. There's another breaking news somewhere between 2011 and 2013 that apparently there has been significant Chinese hacking into petroleum and oil companies in United States. But we'll cover, we are doing some research, we'll cover that tomorrow.
Absolutely, we will. And is Iran behind the new rocket fire? And is this the new normal in the region? Israeli airstrikes reported south of Aleppo, reports Syrian media, with a factory and research center targeted. Rockets land near Afghan president and Taliban denies responsibility. Afghan army chief to visit India next week to interact with top security officials. As if things were, it was not enough that the three eyes were very, very active. Now we have another smoking cauldron in Afghanistan, sir.
It is. I think Afghan has become a real flashpoint with a confluence of global political powers or aspiring powers trying to have their finger in the pie. What exactly is going to be the outcome? You know, one shudders to think about, but you can see that there are issues. Why the Afghan army chief is visiting India? What exactly is the scope of his discussion in the middle of these issues? You know, one begs the question as Taliban continues to gain space in the region. Apparently, U.S. just announced that almost 95-96% of its troops have left, and there's very small portions left, remnants left. And there's also issues looming around what's going to happen to all those Afghan citizens and allies who coordinated and cooperated with the logjams in terms of processing their visas.
And Russia's test launch of Zircon missile is likely to change warfare rules. Russia also likely to unveil a new fifth-generation fighter aircraft at an air show near Moscow. A promotional video featuring pilots from India, United Arab Emirates, Vietnam, and Argentina was shown, demonstrating interest for export. It is pitched against the US F-35 stealth fighter, according to Russian experts. Now, Russia is starting to show off all its arms and ammunition.
Russia is clearly demonstrating in each of the fields that it is competing. It is, if it is not ahead, it is at least on par. You saw that with Russian Sputnik vaccine. You saw that with the space program. Now with this supersonic missile or hypersonic missile, which they're launching called as the Zircon, which can be launched from submarines, which can be launched from ships. Apparently, it is a big game changer in terms of the war, conventional warfare is concerned. Now they're unveiling the next generation, fifth generation fighter aircraft, probably competes with Rafael and the F-35s. And what they have done the promotional with India, Vietnam, and Argentina, including UAE. UAE and Vietnam are big buyers of U.S. equipment. Of course, India's number one arms supplier is Russia. So you've got all these people lined up promoting that video, simply implies that Russia is targeting these countries for export. Given the present situation in the United States, one will not be surprised if new partnerships is formed with Russia in this particular field.
And France investigates alleged Pegasus spyware use against dissidents. It is alleged again that it was Morocco that was spying on some French diplomats as well as the president, Macron. And again, these are all allegations. We have no proof of whether it was actually one other country spying. But why Morocco is another interesting question. So your thoughts on where this Pegasus spyware is headed, because this is a worldwide thing.
Well, I think the Pegasus, it's conceivable that some of the software may be present. Whether they actually were used for spying or whether they were discovered and somebody is using it for political advantage or to create enough ruckus in the ecosystem remains to be seen. Why they have targeted Macron? Macron is, is considered the man who is holding EU together because he is the right, whereas most of the other governments in EU or in the Western Europe are social democrats or with socialistic principles. And so you have France being targeted, and you have the French journalists in Morocco. Plus, apparently, there's a lot of NGOs, key political figures, etc. What you call alleged theory. The question is, we'll have more proof. This seems to have also spilled into India. So the two countries which is in the radar with, as it relates to this Pegasus, is India and France. And Pegasus has denied that it has anything to do with this stuff or formally involved. I think one of the Israeli companies has even sued the Wire, which was responsible for publication of the specific report.
And in India news, Indian government will not repeal the farm laws while prepared to speak with the agitating farmers. India's macroeconomic fundamentals are strong. Recovery underway, according to Deepak Parekh, the HDFC chairman. He further added that the first half of fiscal year 21 was weaker, impacted by COVID, while the second half looks stronger. Your thoughts on the Indian economy and on what is happening in India?
Well, I think that each and every day you are getting endorsements from many people who look at the data. Mr. Parekh, who runs the HDFC, is very well known, and you know, he knows, he has been looking at the economy for many, many years, or many decades, if I have to say. So it's a good news from an Indian point of view. And we have reported consistently various indicators, exports, agro, power, steel, energy, the uptick in the economy. So as far as 2022 is concerned, India seems to be well on its way, which is also endorsed by the chief economic advisor. It begs the question, can India hit that 8% rate or still hover around the 6.5 to 7.5% rate as it looks beyond? Because what you are seeing in the FY22 is the latent effects of the economy's reopening post-COVID relative to FY21 in an Indian economic calendar, as far as Indian economic calendar goes. The mere real question is FY22. The other question is, what else is coming by way of COVID, Delta and Delta pass, which could create further headwinds to the global economic recovery?
Expect turnover from foods to touch up to 10,000 crores, says Marico chairman. 6.66 lakh direct and indirect jobs are generated by 22 operational mega food parks, says the Indian government. Kirana stores to go digital, with more than 2,000 stores automating inventory management, and 5,000 is a target for 2022. Stores have further upgraded to serve customers via omni-channel, by phone, by WhatsApp, and even branded app. So India is making a major push in food sector, as well as trying to empower the Kirana stores.
Kirana, yes, as I mean, you covered this, and P. Gurus has covered this in the fireside chat, and there was Suhail's discussions, which revolved around how do we kind of uplift and digitize Kirana stores that cannot be left behind. It seems like they are also changing the tune with times. Digitization of their inventory management, customer-facing apps, which allows them to place orders during this pandemic period. Plus, I think they are augmenting, this is the research report that I saw, they are augmenting the delivery capabilities, notwithstanding the fact most of these stores are quite adjacent in a village neighborhood. But the good news is that there is a momentum towards automating and taking them forward. Rather, it is not disruptive, but it is transformative, at least based on the agenda. I think the food box is a great concept. It brings a lot of semi-skilled other types of labor into employment potential. This concept of 5,000 jobs per food park, or some 3 to 5,000 jobs per food park, is a great idea. And this is one of the sectors where the economy has more or less come back to normal, to pre-pandemic levels, retail and food.
Retail sales in June have improved to 50% of prior to COVID levels. Food and grocery sales near full recovery, which is what you just said. Housing sector drives cement demand for April-May quarter of 2021. So once the housing starts happen, that's again an indication that things are coming back to normal, isn't it, sir?
Yeah, it is. It is. I stand corrected. I meant grocery stores rather than retail. So grocery stores and food, grocery sales and food stores have come back. Retail is still making its way up. Retail is much broader. Yes, housing sector is, I think, if I'm correct, here in the United States, the healthcare is the number one employer in conjunction with the housing sector. So housing sector is one of the biggest drivers of employment in India. With the demand picking up, that's a reflection that things are coming back to normal. It's one of the reasons why you saw the cement sales as well going up. And on the steel, we reported yesterday India exported more steel in the last quarter relative to the corresponding period, the previous prior quarter, all reflecting that the heavy industries are also from the manufacturing side making their way as the Indian economy tries to regain its momentum.
In an astonishing report, the former CEA, Dr. Arvind Subramanian, led research report says that COVID-19 related deaths were understated by a factor of 10x, and this report continues on to say that this is without basis. In another astonishing report in Nikkei, the author states that India's vaccine diplomacy is impacted by COVID's second wave. Vaccine diplomacy is long-term and not immediate. Serum India is the largest producer of vaccines, 1.4 billion vaccines per year. This includes many other viruses, not just COVID. I think this is a very, very slanted article. You know that Mr. Subramanian is now suddenly on an economic advisory council for the state of Tamil Nadu. Tamil Nadu is, like every other state in India, is practically bankrupt. They are dependent on the sales of yesterday's TASMAC to pay the salaries of today's government servants. And this is just nonsense. I don't know why this person was even employed for 3 years, sir. That's just my personal opinion. Your thoughts?
Okay, so let's delineate two things. One is, the first is the Dr. Subramanian's report, the separate report which says that, the India has understated the COVID impact by a factor of 10. He goes on to conclude, or he and two other people goes on to conclude, this is based on research, some South Asia Research Foundation observations, and this is based on the research data from experts rather than the actual anecdotal data of evidence, which is what the government has stated. We stand by our data. If you have data, tell us why it is a factor of 10x. So hence, I have stated it is without basis. This is my observation, that it has no basis, but accept a leap of faith conclusion based on observations and based on inferences drawn from the so-called experts. The second one is featured in, I think, written by either Karan Sharma or Kiran Sharma in Nikkei, which says, headline, India's vaccine diplomacy takes a hit as a result of the COVID variant 2 coming into India. Now, the question, therefore, is curing COVID far more important, or is it the vaccine diplomacy that is far more important? It just begs the question, are these article paid and funded articles, which is to basically express an opinion, which is irrelevant. In fact, these guys should be writing about how India has reached 400 million, what it needs to do to get past. When they vary in the first wave, when it was less impacted, India was less impacted, when it found the world struggling, it offered to every country that it approached the vaccines. So there seems to be no contiguous correlation, but opinions expressed which are meant to prove one way. But having said that, these people don't analyze. What is today's India's capacity? What is it doing? It is largest manufacturer of vaccines in the world. It does export a significant part of its vaccines. It did export the hydroxychloroquine when the crisis came. India is the number one producer of hydroxychloroquine. So there seems to be no anecdotal and holistic view, but more a narrow aperture, which is to serve a specific political purpose rather than an intellectual outcome that they want to communicate.
And now let's take a look at United States news. Pride and patriotism towards flag is still the dominant view, polls show. Jeff Bezos delivers as Blue Origin rocket reaches space. So with your permission, what I'll do is I'm putting up the next slide wherein people say that 61% of voters agree with Trump on the need for state election reform. I mean, the flag, the country still is foremost in the minds of Americans, regardless of what the progressives will have you believe. The more important thing is the country now feels that there has to be some significant electoral reforms. Your thoughts, sir?
Indeed. I think that there are two things that came out, right? One is around the flag. You saw a whole specter of people, including the Olympians going to Tokyo Olympics, making statements around the flag as well as what they would do and their allegiance, etc. So basically the research shows that there is tremendous support. The research also shows that to have a fair and justifiable outcome which represents the mindset of the people of the country, one has to have a very transparent electoral process and the reform is needed. So therefore, when you put these two things together, there is still a tremendous aspirational desire to keep the country moving in the right path with the right approach so that the outcomes of the elections puts the right people in the position of power to run the country.
And U.S. can count on me, says Jordan King Abdullah, after meeting the president in the White House and reaffirming the alliance. Pompeo accuses Biden administration of working to make Iran America's senior partner in the Middle East. Biden may send more staff to Havana to support Cuban people. Will Biden do a Zoom call with Gloria Estefan and Andy Garcia to shape his Cuban policy? I mean, this is more of a rhetorical question, I suppose, sir.
No, he has confirmed that he's planning to have a Zoom call with Gloria Estefan and Andy Garcia. He said that he's going to have a call to get their input on the Cuban issue. Plus, he has also stated that that they may send additional staff to Havana to support the aspirational desires of the Cuban people. So I've posed the question, so are they going to shape the Cuban policy? Because he says that he wants to take input from them. In fact, I'll read out what he says. The White House announced Monday President Joe Biden held a Zoom video conference call with Cuban American celebrities in an attempt to organize a policy in response to nationwide anti-communist protests on the island. So this is from the White House. He has held a Zoom call.
And two contradictory statements from Biden. Inflation is here and it's going to get much worse. Ignores bipartisan warnings on stimulus and insists that inflation is temporary. Is it here to stay or is it temporary? That's the question, because the president is saying both at the same time. Chuck Schumer continues his bluster on infrastructure bill and dares the Republicans to vote against it. June inflation report puts Americans on the edge. Lindsey Graham says adding amnesty to infrastructure bill is the dumbest idea ever to make it to the Senate. Who suggested this, sir?
The only one and only one person, which is our AOC, suggested. Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez has suggested that it's time to put all this immigration stuff into the granting amnesty so we can fund it. So it should be part of the infrastructure. Remember, infrastructure bill and health infrastructure bill and the healthcare bill are both the kind of what you call the placeholders, as we say here, to direct them. You have a defund police, you want the fund police movement, you please take money from the healthcare. You have a bankrupt government, you have some immigration surges or illegal immigration surges, you take money from there to address the issue. So it's almost like these budgets have been created as placeholders, so you can take money as needed and dispense them in. So Lindsay is saying, if this is what you guys want to do, no wonder you need, you know, umpteen amount of trillions of dollars to actually get a budget through.
And Florida Governor DeSantis says many migrants are heading straight to Florida after illegally passing through Texas. warning that he has received information from many law enforcement personnel. And we have told you about how they just dissipate into the United States once they cross in. House GOP report hits Biden and Democrats on border crisis as stats show continued migrant surge. This is a clear and present problem. They have messed it up. And if somebody were to wake up and start reading news, they would think that the Democratic Party is only consisting of four members who call themselves by squad. I don't know what happened to the moderate Democrats. Which cat has got their tongue? I don't know what is going on with this border thing. And this whole thing just is very, very dubious, sir. So this is just taking a page out of Congress's playbook when Congress used to resettle Rohingyas all the way from the Burmese-Myanmar border all the way down to Jammu, where the margin of victory was slim. And I might as well add this fact here. Look at the average size of a Rohingya family that is taking refuge in India. 10. Mind-blowing, sir.
Mind-blowing. I think that this is about it. So as we speak, there's another report that has come out which speaks about what's happening on the border and the numbers. We'll cover that. I think, sir, I think you have summarized it very well. There's a huge problem. It seems to be well-directed and well-orchestrated, which is to say, go to this city, go to this state, go to this. So it seems like a very well-orchestrated program. And unless somebody does a specific investigation, it's very hard to find. Only now you can draw a correlatory inference based on the data that is coming out. Anyway, enough said about. But this and this infrastructure bill, this uncontrolled budgets are two biggest threats, headwinds in terms of the onward path of the U.S. economy.
And I have the next bitmap up there, sir. Fauci and Rand Paul trade blows on vaccination research on Delta variant. We had Rand Paul really blasting Fauci on the NIH funding for Wuhan lab. You are trying to obscure responsibility for 4 million people dying. This is just incredible, sir. Your thoughts on this, because we have more COVID-related news. In fact, it is believed that Nancy Pelosi herself has tested positive to COVID-19 after coming into contact with the Texas Democrats. This is one of the most biggest snafus that the Democrats have inflicted upon themselves, in my opinion, sir. I could be wrong. Your thoughts on, first of all, on this Rand Paul Fauci, I should only say conflagration in the committees where they are having these discussions.
Yeah, you'll see three diagrams which will be floating around, three pictures.
Yes.
The first basically says Rand Paul debating with Fauci and saying, did NIH fund Wuhan lab? And did it fund for some gainful purpose? If you knew the data, why you have not shared the data? Why you have not alerted people? Don't you think you could have saved 4 million lives? This is the question. But he's after Fauci to say, what does he know based on the NIH funding that seems to have happened and which is acknowledged by Dr. Fauci himself that the NIH funding did happen as part of the some of the, I don't know, $100,000, $150,000 research grant was given. So this is the first strand of, go back to 2020. They all denied and basically said, you know, nothing is wrong and, you know, it's a research, there's no evidence, then WHO did investigation. All that kind of stuff. Okay, so you see that first picture. Now you go to the second picture, which comes to, you know, you can use whichever you want. Tom Cotton. You can look at Tom Cotton and then say, Democrats last year they said it was racial comment by President Trump to aspire COVID as China virus, right? And they denied China has any role, and now they are confirming. Well, it looks like China virus. WHO did its best and it has successfully renamed as Alpha, Beta, Delta. Now you have Gamma and I don't know what's the next one that is coming. So Tom Cotton is making a very clear statement, which is to say, you call the Wuhan lab theory was a fake and you debunked it. Now you are saying this is the case. Okay, it's a second. Now you come to the third picture, which is namely this great and generous Democrats who quit and didn't attend a special session in Texas and came to White House and met with the representatives and first denied. Now they have, the cases have gone from 3 to 5. It's now confirmed that Nancy Pelosi has tested positive. And then Psaki is basically saying that confirms hiding, you know, some of the staff who seems to have had coronavirus cases testing positive. This is basically White House confirming. So it begs the question, when you look at these three stories, one is around the Wuhan, the second is around the denial, the third is around the COVID situation, which White House is now confirming. What is the honest situation with regard to COVID and the outbreak of COVID? And what is the information that is coming out from White House that can stand the test of integrity? This is the fundamental question which is at stake, because this is a pandemic which is hurting the community and hurting the world. So this is a very interesting, fascinating discussion and fascinating set of activities that basically was encapsulated from yesterday's discussions that has happened in the White House, House, Senate, etc.
And vaccination cry grows all over the country. Do your research and get vaccinated as vaccination rates falter in the United States. Sir, with your permission, now I'd like to go to markets. And we have been seeing some yo-yo-like activity in the markets. And you have markets rose 2% on Tuesday, with stocks rallying and recouping most of the losses of Monday. Today, again, the futures are up. Bargain hunting counterbalanced rising COVID-19 infections. Dine-in restaurants, airlines showed positive momentum in demand. So I'm going to put, with your permission, the next chart on markets to right now, and it's up, sir. Go ahead.
So we are sharing the data from CNBC. End of day data and shows that the Dow Jones up was 549. The Dow Jones futures is up 200 points as we speak right now. S&P was up. All the indices were up. The chart below basically shows, you know, on the prior day, which is namely Monday, we were at 34,200. We took a dip, and by the time we finished end of Tuesday, we had gone past the position that we were in on Monday. So it's basically showing the gyrations are driven by opportunistic activity that is taking place, and the markets are casting aside the inflation issues and moving forward based on earnings and based on bargain hunting opportunities that are going on in the market. The good news is the dine-in restaurants are almost, you know, coming, trying to get back to normalcy. There's demand on the airlines. So there seems to be economic momentum gaining as the markets begin to open, notwithstanding the fact that there is rising Delta variant. There is a positive disposition in the minds of the people. Remember also, United States is 55% fully vaccinated, and they're trying to get that number to somewhere between 70 to 75, which in turn can help to combat the Delta variant.
And with that, our today's Hangout comes to a close. But before I sign off, I just want to update our viewers. We are also adding more platforms to our daily Global Insights, and we will be giving you the data very shortly. Perhaps even as early as next Monday, you will be also able to watch the same program in a higher resolution. If you have, for example, a 5G connection on a 2K bandwidth, we are going to try and give you all that stuff. It will be a different platform. You have to, again, of course, subscribe to that platform in order to get those high quality broadcasts. We are doing everything possible within our control, within our budget, to make sure that you know that this is the factual situation of the world around you. Because everything that we put out is fact by solid research and data. No embellishment. We don't take sides. News is news. News is the truth. Sridharji, thank you very much as always. And tomorrow we'll be back same time, same place. Day after, we are taking a break. We will be coming back on Saturday to cover Friday's news. Thank you very much, sir. And we'll be back again tomorrow.
Thank you. Have a wonderful day. We'll see you tomorrow.